My role here today will be to just to talk about some of the few offerings that the NRF has with regard to funding postgrad students as well as postdoctoral fellows. The most important thing with what we do is how do we address the challenges of equity, of access, success, and throughput rate. And the NRF is of the view that funding becomes a very important lever in making sure that we advance these things. So my presentation will just, you know, focus on what the NRF is and briefly talk about the recently approved postgrad funding policy and the indicative funding values for honors, masters, and doctoral students, and also some of the postdoc opportunities, and finally, conclusions and recommendations. The mandate of the NRF is basically to contribute to national development, and we do this by supporting and promoting and advancing research and human capacity development. This function is mostly done by RISA, and also developing, supporting, and maintaining the National Research Facility. This function is mostly undertaken by national facilities such as Itemba Labs, SKA, SARAO, SANBI, and SION. And also supporting and promoting public awareness of and engagement with science. This function is mostly undertaken by SASTA. And lastly, promoting the development and maintenance of the national science system and support of government priorities. Now, in order for the NRF to discharge its mandate, at the core of it, we have a five-year strategy, we have annual performance plans, and all of these things, they take into cognizance the national priorities such as unemployment, poverty, and inequalities. And for that, the NRF also has to think of various national policies as well as international policies. And some of those policies that the NRF considers, for instance, are your national development plan, things such as your DST 10-year innovation plan, and things as your 2030 agenda for sustainable development goals. And the NRF, we also have the transformation agenda or transformation framework that has four pillars. And for the purpose of this conversation, I'll only focus on this pillar, which is transforming equity profiles of the postgrad students and researchers. I won't talk about the other ones. They are not relevant for this platform. So to this extent, the NRF has, we have recently developed a postgrad student funding policy. And in formulating this policy, the principles of equity, of opportunity in relation to access, success, throughput, and representativity were adopted, and these principles are underpinned by the pursuit of research excellence in all its dimensions. Research excellence, as well as the attainment of certain academic thresholds, are a requirement for eligibility for the NRF postgrad student funding. So part of this policy talks to the nine policy choices that the NRF has deliberately taken in making sure that we transform the postgrad lending, the postgrad space, as well as the researcher space. And the first policy clause is that the NRF will include financial need as a criterion when we allocate scholarships or bursaries. to those that might be aware of it, what we've been saying previously as the NRF, we've always been saying that we will prioritize students that are financially needy. Now, this policy is making it explicit where the NRF is saying we will fund students that are financially needy, and those students, and how we define students that are financially needy, it's students that will come from a combined family household income of less than 350 per annum. And the NRF is going to partner with an organization such as ISFAP as well as NSFAS, where, for instance, we are going to be considering undergraduate students that were funded by these two bodies. And when those students, when they come to enroll for their postgrad, the NRF will prioritize those students in terms of funding. But we're not just going to be prioritizing people for funding by virtue of the fact that they were financially needy. Of course, academic excellence is going to play a critical role. And for students who are financially needy, this will be the minimum requirements that they will have to attain to. And what we're also saying is that if you come in as a financially needy student, you'll be funded without interruption from your honors all the way to PhD. If you enter at master's, we'll fund you continuously all the way to PhD. And all that you need to attain will be these standards, for instance. And also the NRF is going to make provision for students with disability. So the same modality as for students who are financially needy is going to apply. Additionally, for students with disability, we are going to be offering them the additional funding of up to 20,000 of an assistive technology device. What we'll also do is that we will make provision for exceptionally academic achievers. These students, they don't necessarily have to be financially needy, they don't necessarily have to be disabled, they don't have to be female or male. As long as you come in the system and you have obtained the following academic standards, you will be considered for NRF funding. And again, these students, if they come in at honors and they maintain these high academic standards, we will fund them continuously until their PhD. Policy clause number five, if you cannot be funded either as a financially needy student, a student with disability, or an academically excellent student, you will be considered for a partial cost of study. In the next coming slides, I will break down exactly what constitutes a full cost of study and what constitutes a partial cost of study. The next slide just gives a summary of the previous policy choices that I've talked about. For instance, for students who will be considered for a full cost of study, it will only be South African citizens and permanent residents, and those students will either be exceptionally academic achievers or financially needy students or students with disability. And of course, they do have different entry requirements, as you can see on the slides. What we're saying here is that if you enter at honors and you maintain and you enter at that a minimum academic requirement, if you keep the same minimum requirement, we will fund you until PhD. And the same thing for financially needy students and students with disability. For any other students that we probably due to budget constraints, if we can't fund you under these categories, you will then be considered under the so-called partial cost of study. And this is where we will also include that 5% of the international students. The nice thing about what we are proposing is that if you happen to enter at a partial cost of study, and when you progress over to master's, you then attain a 75% mark, we will move you from a partial cost of study to a full cost of study, and the same will also apply. If you enter at full cost of study, and for one reason or the other, you don't meet the minimum, the NRF minimum requirement, for instance, you obtain a 65% mark, we will then move you over to partial cost of study. Policy clause number six talks to the NRF will only be prioritizing, for this policy, will only be prioritizing full-time students. We will still be considering part-time students, but those will only be considered under programs like Tutuka and the BEP program, which I will talk to later. For policy clause number 7, what the NRF is saying is that we have to make sure that we get our doctoral graduates to be completing their PhDs much younger. The benefit when people complete their PhD younger is that they can stay on the system for a long period of, and we can get to harness and get as much as we can from them. One of the things that we have done, we have actually seen that for a person who starts their postdoc, in order for them to be A-rated, it will take them approximately about 20 years of age. So if we take the assumption that you will complete your PhD at age 35, it simply means that by age 55, you will be A-rated, and you will still be in the system, so you're not, we're not talking about retirement or anything like that. So this is the reason why the NRF, we want to get our graduates to graduate their doctoral degrees younger. And one of the considerations, again, is that if you look at the PSET report for the 2017 academic year, in the system we had about 200,000 postgrad students, honors students at about 100,000, master students 30,000, PhD students at about 30,000. And if you look in terms of the number of students that the NRF funded in 2017, we funded about 15,000, between 14,000 and 15,000. And of the 100,000, the NRF only funded about 5,000 honors students. And of the 30,000 master students, the NRF only funded about 3,000. And of the 30,000 PhD students, the NRF only funded about also about 3,000, 3.5. So that shows you that even for the NRF itself, we are unable to fund all the students that we have in the system. You can talk about the funding that is allocated to undergrad student. If you look at NSFAS funding, which amounts to billions of rands, and if you look at the amount of funding that we get for the postgrad space, it's only about 1 billion. So you can see huge disparities in terms of funding between undergrad students and postgrad students. In terms of policy clause number 8, what comes out clear to those that are aware of the so-called ministerial guidelines from the former DST or now DSI, what the document was alluding to previously was that the NRF needs to fund 87% of the scholarship must go to South African citizens and permanent residents, 13% must go to international students, and 80% to black students, 55% must go to female students. What the policy is saying is that all of those targets are now going to be upped, where, for instance, 95% of the scholarships will now be attributed to South African citizens and permanent residents, and then only 5% will be attributed to students from the SADC countries and the rest of the world. And we're still going to maintain that 55% of the scholarships going to women. In terms of the South African component, the NRF is now going to be funding 90% of the students must be black, and by black we mean African, colored, and Indian. And then 10% of the scholarship will go to white students, and then 1% to students with disabilities. You will remember the previous ministerial guidelines was talking about 4% of students with disabilities. Unfortunately, that 4% target was a bit unrealistic. If you look at the number of the disabled students that we have in the system, it's only about 0.3%. That is of the 1.2 million students that we have. This is undergrad and postgrad student. Only 8,700 students are students with disability. So that target of 4% was a bit unrealistic. It was not taking certain things into considerations that are happening at the universities. Now, if you look at the performance of the NRF, if you look at the previous ministerial guidelines and you look at what is being proposed going forward, you will see that how the NRF performed in the last academic year. For honors student, everything was all good and well. 90% of the students that were funded were black, 60% were female, and in terms of the citizen distribution, there was no problem there. For masters, we had a bit of a challenge with 78% of the students being black. Female, there was no problem. And again, when it came to citizen distribution, there was no problem there. But with PhD and postdoc, this is where we're having a bit of a challenge. In the sense that we are unable to meet our target for black students, and also in terms of the citizen distribution, when it comes to international student, we're not funding students according to how the NRF is expected. But the reason for this has to do with enrollment at the universities. If you look at honors, masters, and PhD, you will see that in our universities, at honors, there's about 4% of students that are enrolled are international students. If you look at masters, it's about 15% of the students that are enrolled are international students. But when it comes to PhD, it is as high as 35% of the students that are enrolled at PhD are international students. And that has to do primarily with the fact that you can read this on Morton studies. PhD in South Africa is quite attractive in the sense that it's cheaper to do your PhD in South Africa compared to doing it in the UK or the US or anywhere else in the world. So many students see South Africa as an affordable destination for them to do their PhD. And also our PhD is highly regarded. You know, if you think of universities like Stellenbosch, University of Pretoria, UCT, and. So this is the reason why you will see this high percentage of your postdoc as well as your PhD students. And of course, how the NRF funds will be representative of the enrollments in our universities. In terms of policy clause number 9, policy clause number 9 deals with the fact that what the NRF funds needs to support the mandate of the NRF. And the NRF has taken a strategic decision in saying that we're not going to be funding undergraduate qualification regardless of their NQF exit level. For instance, students that are doing engineering, when they exit at NQF level 8. And if you look at your honors general qualification, that's NQF level 8. If you look, for instance, at your postgrad diplomas, their NQF exit level is NQF level 8. So what the NRF is saying is that we're not going to be funding postgrad diplomas as well as your undergraduate qualification, regardless of the exit level. We are not going to be funding masters by coursework only, and we're also not going to be supporting professional masters and doctoral degrees. The NRF is of the view that strategically, these qualifications, they do not support the mandate of the organization. Hence, there is inclination more towards your general qualifications that lead into a research path. So if you look at the funding values for honors and masters, to those that are aware of this information, at honors, currently the NRF gives about 60,000, at masters, 90,000, at PhD, it's 120. Now, one of the quagmires, one of the conundrums within the NRF is that if you look at other organizations like SANBI, SKA, CSIR, and the trend is also the same. If you look at ARC, MRC, their funding values at honors, masters, and PhD are significantly higher than that of the NRF. For instance, a student at SANBI will be getting these values. For instance, SKA, 140 honors. CSIR, that student is getting close to about 150. At masters and doctoral, that student is getting 170 and 190 for masters and doctoral, respectively. But at the NRF, somehow, the tables are turned around. So what we are proposing for 2021, for the 2021 academic year, we're saying that The value of the scholarship for honors is going to be around 150. For masters, it's going to be around 170. For PhD, it's going to be around 185. We have not had this inflationary increases that other organizations have had the luxury of doing. So you will see that the NRF scholarship values, they sort of stagnate at 60,000 for a very long time, PhD 120 for a very long time. If we do get additional money from the NRF, we'll then decide, okay, it's fine, we're going to increase by 10,000. But we're not really thinking, you know, through that process of how we increase this. But for the new policy, we're saying that we are going to be deliberate in factoring the inflationary increases and other realities that are there. Now, one of the things that is quite demotivating, if you look at students that are funded at the undergraduate space, for instance, your NSFAS student will roughly get about 150. Your ISFAP undergrad student will get also around 150. Your SKA student will get also roughly about 150. Your CSIR undergraduate student will also get roughly around 150. Now, here is a student who is funded at an undergraduate level at these values. And then they come to the NRF to do masters, and they get a 60,000 scholarship for honors. You know, what message are we sending in terms of the value of those qualifications? Hence, for instance, these decisions for us to up the bursary values. There's a slide that I did not put through here because I thought it was too much detail. The only downside about having to increase the value of the scholarships to these amounts, for instance, like I said, for the previous financial year, we funded about between 14 and 15,000 students. The downside is that in 2021, when we start implementing these bursary values, we're only going to be funding about 8,000 students. So it means we're going to drop from 14,000, 15,000 to about 8,000. And the impact of it is that, unfortunately, we're going to be funding lesser and lesser students. But the good thing about it is that we are going to be funding students extensively. If you read studies by Morton, Morton indicates that one of the things that that makes students not to complete their PhDs in record time, it's the fact that the bursary values are not sufficient. And what that does is it forces students to then look for other ways of supplementing their scholarship. And part of that process of them having to supplement their scholarship means that they have to sacrifice their time away from the lab and, you know, their research work and. So what we have, if we zoom into the different categories of what we'll be funding, so the NRF will be funding, will be making provision for a personal care or living allowance. We'll also be making a meal and food allowance, the maximum accommodation allowance, also maximum tuition fee, and we'll also be making provision for electronic study device. Students that will be funded at the full cost of study will get all of these things. However, students that are funded at partial cost of study will only be eligible for accommodation and tuition fee allowance. You will see that the personal care living allowance from honors to masters to PhD, it increases. The reality of the matter is that at PhD, you get your so-called senior student. Majority of them might be having kids, majority of them might be married. So we have to make provision for them because they are senior students. And they might have an affinity of not wanting to stay on campus, so they might prefer a different mode of living, hence we had to increase that. The meal allowance will be kept the same for all of them. In terms of the accommodation, for accommodation and for tuition fee, what we did was we actually did some benchmarking where we looked at all the 26 universities that we have in the country, and for honors, masters, and PhD, only three universities were actually above that maximum allocation for tuition fee and for accommodation. And those universities are mostly in the Cape. And we will also make available the electronic study device. For students with disabilities, we will continue to make, for instance, available that assistive technology device provision for them. In terms of when the call is going to open, what is important for you guys to note, apologies for that red color. But what is important is to note that the call will open next year, 1st of April, for masters and for honors, masters and doctoral students. The call will open 1st of April. What is important now with what the NRF is planning to do, because part of the question is, how is the NRF going to determine if a student is financially needy? We are going to be partnering with ISFAP, and what ISFAP will be able to do for the NRF, they will be able to assess if a student is financially needy or not. In other words, they'll be able to provide the NRF with information that says so-and-so is below 350, so-and-so is up, is more than 350. And that will assist the NRF in making a decision as to whether to fund that student under full cost of study or partial cost of study. However, what we're aiming for ultimately is to make sure that by this time next year, the NRF must have communicated the outcomes to all the students who will have applied. The outcomes for honors have been deliberately delayed because of just how sophisticated that process of getting students admitted into an honors program when the marks are available to the to those students, and so it is impossible for us to be able to conclude this process by December. But what we have made provision for is to make provision for the fact that by the time those honors students register, at least they should know whether they have been awarded funding or not. What happened this year was quite an unfortunate situation. We had a situation where some of the universities will approve students' honors funding as late as May, as late as April. And the implication for many of the disadvantaged students between February and April and May, what is that student eating? Where is the student sleeping? And the implication, the reality of it is that many of those students were then forced to abandon their studies. And for the NRF, then what we had to contend with was when those students go to the DST or now the DSI to complain that our funding is not coming on time. So the NRF had to come to some sort of an agreement with universities as how can we make sure that we give students an indication of when they can get their funding. Also, the fact that we have to make these funding decisions earlier, it creates some form of normalcy in the system, in the sense that the researchers are able to plan in saying that I am going to have students, and students are also able to determine their future in saying, am I going to study or am I going to go look for employment? In terms of the postdoctoral fellowships, these are the postdoctoral fellowship opportunities that we have. I'm not going to talk about the PDP one. That is quite a special program that doesn't necessarily fit in here. In terms of what we're giving for the postdocs, we are trying to phase out this NRF postdoctoral freestanding postdoc because we feel that it's significantly lower compared to the money that we get from DST as well as the one that we get from DHET. In terms of the total amount that the NRF makes provision for, it's close to about 400,000 per fellow. We also have the Black Academics Advancement Program. We do this in collaboration with the First Rand Foundation. We do this to promote the development of Black African South African academic researchers. We have the doctoral track with a 3-year sabbatical grant. We also have the postdoctoral track with a 2-year sabbatical grant. In terms of the eligibility of both tracks, you need to be South African citizens for both of them. You need to be a full-time academic employed at a public research institution, and also these other things that are mentioned here. In terms of the support that is provided, it is provided mostly for three distinct budget categories. That is running expenses, lecture replacement cost, as well as the international travel. To conclude, the NRF funding criteria is underpinned by the pursuit of research excellence. in all its dimensions and has transformation of postgrad students and postdoctoral fellows cohort as the core objective. And the purpose of the postgrad funding is to retain high academic achievers in the system to pursue postgrad studies up to the level of doctoral as part of the national drive to grow the next generation of academics to sustain our knowledge enterprise. And the postgrad funding policy aims to fast track the development of postgrad students in high impact, priority, and vulnerable disciplines critical for national socioeconomic development. And lastly, to encourage students to complete their doctoral studies by their mid-30s. The NRF funded students that complete their degree within the NRF funding period will be funded without interruptions from honors up to the doctoral level, provided that they meet the university minimum entry requirement as well as the NRF minimum academic requirement. For all the NRF funding opportunities, you are more than welcome to visit that site. Thank you.